Okay, good morning, everybody. It's 10 o'clock now, so we're going to begin this session. So welcome to the rural water supply theme. This is a very broad theme, actually had the greatest number of papers submitted for this conference. So we've divided things up into a number of sort of sub-themes. So I guess the common thread, it sort of says pumps, it's not necessarily exclusively about pumps, but the main thing about this morning session, the common thread is sort of hopefully we're going to get to see quite a bit of data. So for nerds like me that like to see data and graphs, I look forward to this presentation, and these three presentations. So first of all, we've got Naja Robinson from Design Outreach, based in Ohio in the US, sharing some data about from life pumps, deep borehole pumps, and their data analytics. Then we're moving on to Bryan McSorley and Angus McBride. Bryan is here to answer questions from Oxfam. We'll be talking about solar pumping with some of the incredible new advances in that from Cox's Bazar in Bangladesh. And then finally, we'll be looking at GIS-based systems for managing handpump maintenance and sustainability in Ghana, to be presented by Bryan Ramirez from Villanova University. So welcome, everybody. I'm going to start with the first presentation now.
Hello. My name is Naja Robinson, and I am presenting on life pump usage data for developing hand pump predictive maintenance analytics, co-authored by Greg Bixler and Abe Wright. We're all familiar with the current challenges to accessing clean water in rural areas where hand pumps are commonly used. There's difficulty in extracting water from ultra-deep boreholes, fluctuating water tables due to seasonal and climate changes, hardware failures, and low access to technology solutions which might provide insight into hand pump uptime. At Design Outreach, we've designed the LifePump, which can reach up to 2 to 3 times deeper than the standard pump, and was designed for a 5-year maintenance interval under typical usage, which is defined as 5 hours per day by various wash implementers. We further developed a technology called the LifePump Link in partnership with Sunset Solutions, which is shown here in this little blue box attached to the front of the LifePump. With the LifePump Link, we can remotely collect usage data daily via satellite transmissions. Along with another key partner, E2 Info Systems, we provide access to dashboards, graphics, and reports to get insight on each pump's performance. Our initial results show wide variation in average usage from community to community. The dashboard, which offers both a maps and a list view, provides a custom-defined quick overview of installed pumps for any given NGO or country or our entire installed base. By hovering over one of the sites, one can see what is happening at that community's hand pump. In this case, the Lefolo Malawi site is flagged with a yellow warning because of lower than expected usage. We have the option to view usage for the last 30, 60, 90, or 120 days. There's quite a lot we can glean from just the usage reports and the color-coded alerts. For instance, this first report from Bombardopolis, Haiti, shows a 90-day usage average around 15 hours per day. That is considered a very high-use hand pump. All green lights on the dashboard tell us that all systems are go. However, government water ministries and NGOs might determine that additional hand pumps are needed in this community simply because the demand is so very high. Bombardopolis, by the way, is our deepest hand pump at 150 meters. Now, the second graph here is just the opposite. It shows a very low usage pump in Kanundwa, Zambia. The yellow life pump usage status is telling us the pump was used for less than 30 minutes on a particular day. If that had been the case for more than 5 days in a row, that flag would turn red. The third graph here, another from Haiti, is showing great usage for 120 days, but the signal status is red on this particular unit, because no data has been transmitted for more than 5 days. 5 days is the redundancy designed into the system to capture historical data in the event of missing signal transmissions, which can occur due to weather anomalies or even system hiccups. Let's look further at this low usage pump in the middle, Kanungwa, by expanding to a 120-day view on the next slide. The expanded view of usage, combined with the history of alerts, helps paint a story for us to understand both the community usage needs and to feed a machine learning algorithm for predictive analytics. The orange flag, for instance, tells us that the battery level has dropped below a threshold and will need replacing soon. The alerts history tells us just how low the usage was on any given day. What we know from the NGO partner is that this particular pump is used as a backup to another proximate to it. And so that explains why this pump is used so little. But in some cases, it may be a borehole issue or an issue with the pump itself. Either way, having access to the usage data is informative for potential resource reallocation if that's deemed necessary or appropriate. Here's a scenario where a sudden drop in usage did warrant a service dispatch. Yeshea Sumba, Malawi. A yellow alert on the dashboard warranted further investigation, and the uncharacteristic drop-off led to sending a pump technician to investigate. He discovered the problem. In this case, it was a rotor pin and an older generation design of the stator. He replaced it, and the community was quickly restored with access to water. Very critical to this community, which we can see is averaging almost 8 hours of usage per day. The last graph on this page is simply showing us the 7-day moving average over the course of a year of monitoring this site. And we see the maintenance event as a blip on the radar, though nonetheless one we want to attend to as rapidly as possible as we're striving for near 100% uptime. Very quickly, this slide presents a snapshot of the data aggregated into a table for the 61 sites that are being monitored. Also in the table are the pump depth, the number of days monitored, and the age of the hand pump installed. The summary results found in the last four rows are better represented graphically on the next slide. Highlights: the average daily usage is just under 5 hours per day at 4 hours and 51 minutes, tracking quite closely with the initial targeted standard. The pumps being monitored average almost 3 years in age, though a fair amount are between 4 and 8 years, and over half the pumps for which we have data have been monitored for more than 6 months, and 30% have been monitored for more than a year. The average daily usage data for the 61 sites is shown here, and the highlights are noted in the box. The yellow line is reflecting for us the percentage of days monitored that any given pump was used for less than 30 minutes, and we see only a very few where that number isn't zero. Bombardopolis is the first pump there. That's our deepest pump at the 150 meters we talked about earlier. And then on the far right, at 70%, we see that low use pump we talked about, Kanundwa. The red line is showing us that 99% of the days monitored, pumps have some usage. In a recently published RWSN article, the case was made for the life pump achieving 5-year maintenance intervals under typical usage. This table shows 5 of the 26 pilot communities with long-standing operational life pumps. It includes the pre-maintenance event, the maintenance interval duration, and then the subsequent maintenance event. Let's look in more detail at a couple of these, our oldest pumps, Chalequa in the first row and Zalamondo in the last row. Chalequa's life pump was installed almost 8 years ago and went almost 6 years before any maintenance was performed, with no interruptions in operational service. This community was decidedly selected to be one which received no component upgrades in order to establish the 5-year maintenance claim. The site averages about 9.25 hours per day of usage. And we can see in the picture with the woman watering the garden, one of the many positive impacts to a community where there is continuous access to water for 8 years is that you can grow a garden in the dry season. Another community, actually the oldest to have a life pump by only a few days more than Chalequa, is Zalamondo. Its longest maintenance interval is just over 4 years, and it follows critical to quality component upgrades, which Chalequa did not receive until much later. This site has been monitored for over 18 months and is another high usage pump at 8 hours per day. We hypothesize that pump reliability will be a function of load, which is directly correlated to pump depth and usage, and of course the age of the pump itself. So at a usage of 5 hours per day times 365 days and 5 years of usage, which we're targeting before preventative maintenance is required, would take us to 9,125 hours of usage before preventative maintenance. But what else did we need to know to establish preventative maintenance predictors? We thought about it analogous to a car, where every 3 months or 3,000 miles you would get an oil change, or every 5 years or 50,000 miles you would replace tires. We started with actual usage, which for any given pump is that pump's daily average usage times the number of days installed. Of course, our confidence in this estimation increases as the number of days monitored increases. In the case of Zalamondo, we're estimating actual usage at 7.63 hours per day times basically 7.6 years, which equals 21,000 hours. While the pump's been physically installed for 7.6 years, we can normalize its age against a targeted usage of 1,800 hours about per year. Remember that 5 times 365? And when we do that, Zalamondo has been used more like that of a pump aged 11 and a half years, not 7.6. For sites monitored for more than 1 year, we have a fairly high confidence in our calculated actual usage and normalized age estimates. The graph on the left is showing the normalized age for 18 such sites. But more interestingly, the graph on the right is showing the normalized age against the calendar age for those same pumps. Zalamondo is shown in red in the upper right-hand corner. Anything above the line, the diagonal line, is reflecting pumps being used at a greater than typical rate. And those below the line reflect pumps being used at a less than typical rate. So, for instance, though not labeled here, Canundwa is the bottommost, farthest right-hand mark. Actually 6.38 years installed, but its normalized age is less than 1 year. Notice those pumps that track right along with the line. If we expand our data set to include pumps monitored for 6 months or more, we can look at 37 sites. The left-hand graph plots daily average time in use against pump depth. And if we translate that usage across the actual life of the pump, we get the plot to the right, normalized age versus pump depth. Everything within the blue box there represents pumps operating within a range in which we would not expect preventative maintenance to be necessary yet. Zalamondo, Chalakwa, Yeshaya Shumba, Bombardopolis, they're all highlighted there. It's interesting to see how each site moves with respect to its location on the graph in the left compared to that on the right. For instance, Chalakwa, the green marker at just above 80 meters deep and 9 hours per day on the first graph, it moves away from the typical usage bullseye and presents as 14 years old on the second graph. Both graphs are informative for different purposes, as is information like expected life cycle of critical components. Combined, this all feeds the design of an early warning system for maintenance of hand pumps, akin to an automobile check engine light equivalency. In closing, we anticipate expanding the development of logic along with the growing database of usage data and existing maintenance data to provide predictive maintenance analytics to a host of end users, government water ministries, NGOs, funders. In the end, our goal is to provide technology solutions that would maximize uptime and therefore continuous access to clean water for rural communities dependent upon hand pumps. Finally, I'd like to thank my co-authors and co-workers, Greg Bixler and A. Wright, co-founders of Design Outreach. Thank you very much.
That was great. Thank you very much, Naja, for that presentation. Great to see such amazing data being collected. And we're gathering a few questions, I think. But just to kick us off, maybe you could explain a little bit more about the kind of operation and maintenance context for this, because I'm not quite clear on sort of where who the data actually goes to and what it triggers. What's the sort of governance system like for the management of these drill holes? Is LifeWater doing this as under a service level agreement, or how is all of that working?
Yes, of course. Absolutely. The intention and the ideas that we have are various NGO implementers who have license or access to the data on a sort of licensing fee system. And so they would be able to access their daily data. They would be able to have insight. In fact, our desire is that they would be the ones who would proactively be monitoring their own dashboards. That said, we also, with an interest of maintaining that uptime, would simultaneously be tracking that data. And the level of access is dependent upon who you are. So for instance, a partner would have access at the level of their installed base. And then they could, as the installed base grows, they can provide additional accounts and additional access to different employers of them, different maintenance workers, different installers, government agencies. We have not done this yet, but our intention is that water ministries would have access as well. And so they would have access at maybe a regional level, which would include multiple partners, pumps that are installed. And so that's the idea.
Fantastic. Yeah, and I guess, you know, thinking about what's coming up in the sort of next presentation, I guess there's these two sort of alternative futures here in terms of the technology for pump supplies. I'm wondering whether that, you know, you see the future as being these smarter hand pumps and how that competes with what's the obviously the growth of solar technology. Do you have a view on that?
Yeah. And I may throw this one to my co-author Abe as well, but I'll take a stab initially. So we just believe that there's room for multiple types of implementations. Absolutely. In fact, we're working on a solar implementation as well, which we call the Auto Life Pump. And so we would envision that even with the Auto Life Pump, we would collect the same kind of usage data and that would be provided. We actually do have one that is at our test lab right now that is an auto life pump that is run with a solar. And it also does have a life pump link monitor attached to it where we are collecting that data. So that's pretty fascinating to be able to see too, to see that usage being monitored and seeing how what hours of the day that's running to be able to kind of correlate with solar access. Abe, you want to take that one as well?
Yeah, thanks, Naja. And that was great. And I would just add that we really see a place for hand pumps still, even with the increase in solar systems. A lot of the implementing partners that we talk to admit that it takes a certain size of population and a certain location in order for the operation and maintenance cost to basically be feasible for a solar system and all the consumables that go along with it. So we're really, our niche for the life pump is communities that are smaller than could be served by a solar system. We don't say the life pump's for everyone, but there are still, we believe, tens of thousands of communities that need a reliable hand pump and will for years to come.
So there's a question here related, you may kind of feel like you've already answered it, but in terms of sustainability of that kind of data collection and how all of that's funded and what's the cost of it. So I don't know if you can see that question in the chat from Joe.
Mm-hmm. Yes. So from a sustainability of the data perspective, well, we all know that we're living in a world where we seem to feel there is no end to data. So there are a couple of different models that we have in mind. One would be that this would be an ongoing, for the life of the pump itself, you would collect the data. So that's one model. And then the transmission fees at this point are between $75 and $125 a year to maintain that. Another option is that partners may want to have a life pump link on their systems for 1 or 2 years to establish a baseline of that community use and do community planning and then repurpose that life pump link at another pump. So yeah, there are a number of possibilities and options that are available for partners. And from a cost perspective, It is one of the things we're hosting the data now here, and it, you know, it's the world we're living in.
Brilliant. Thanks very much for that. There may be some more questions that appear in the chat. So if you carry on following through this session, maybe you can give some answers there through the chat as well. So I noticed yesterday it takes some people a while to kind of formulate their question, by which time we've moved on to the next talk. But the great thing about having the chat there is you can carry on dialoguing about that. So we're going to start with the next presentation. So this is from Angus McBride and Bryan McSorley from Oxfam, who will be talking about solar pumping, as we've just been mentioning.
This presentation highlights some factors affecting the performance of solar pumps in Kutapalong Mega Camp. The context is particularly interesting, as solar pumping has never been deployed at such large scale in a humanitarian context. For those not familiar with the Rohingya crisis, in 2017 there was a mass movement of people fleeing violence and persecution in Myanmar. 700,000 refugees settled in Kutapalong, which in a matter of weeks became the largest refugee camp in the world, with drinking water being supplied by thousands of shallow tube wells fitted with hand pump, often just a few metres away from a latrine. Due to obvious concerns on groundwater quality and public health, and an expectation that refugees would be there for the long term, in 2018, Oxfam was asked by the WASH sector to lead development of a water master plan. The total footprint of the camp covers an area of 50 square kilometres, and the master plan divided the camp into over 100 catchment zones based on topography. And it was envisaged that each catchment would have its own independent pipe network. Kutapalong is situated in the southeast of the country below Chittagong, where irradiation is most favourable. There's still a concern whether in the monsoon months, solar pumping systems will be able to provide sufficient water. This graph shows a drop in irradiation during the monsoon season. The review was undertaken at the end of 2019, a little over 1 year into the implementation of the master plan. At this time, 30 schemes were operational, while others were under construction. Following a desk review of information held by implementing agencies, we arranged focus groups with water users, visited 17 water networks, and downloaded pump performance data from all sites with Lawrence pumps using the manufacturer's pump scanner smartphone app. This provided up to 9 months of data on production and operating hours. During a two-week study, we also deployed rugged troll data loggers to monitor water levels in several water storage tanks to get a better understanding of how systems are operating. There's a lot of data in this table, but essentially it was a starting point comparing the actual design output with actual production. It confirmed that the majority of systems are either underperforming or being underutilized. There's only two networks highlighted here in yellow where actual production is close to the design expectation. Translating this to average amount of water per person, there's also a big variation between systems in different sections of the camp. The average was just below the severe indicator of 15 litres per person per day. Four sites were supplying 20 litres or more, which is the UNHCR standard, and four were supplying less than 10 litres. In terms of reliability, there's only two or three systems able to provide over 15 litres per person per day for 90% of the time. Areas of lowest solar output tend to coincide with sections of the camp where there's a proliferation of hand pumps, and this is a significant factor explaining the difference in performance. But it's not the only factor, as I'll show. This graph shows the relationship between water coming into the system through the solar pump, outflow at tap stands, and change in storage. Collection starts between 5 and 6 a.m., which is the green bar in the graph. Pumping commences a few minutes to 7, which is the red bar, and by 10 a.m., the pump has reached maximum output. And by 12, the blue line shows the tank storage plateauing out, showing the reservoir is full, so the pump switches itself off, and only later in the afternoon, when the level in the tank drops, the pump restarts. People in this section of the camp are receiving 25 litres of water per person, and this shows that there's plenty of spare capacity in the system to accommodate increased demand and seasonal variations when cloud cover may reduce the pump rate. Tap stands in this system are open 24/7, so people can collect water whenever suits them. Contrast that with a system which was giving much lower output and people are receiving only 10 litres of water per person. On first appearance, there's plenty of water here. On this particular day, the tank is never less than half full, and by 10 a.m., The reservoir is full, consequently the solar pump is only running intermittently. So throughout the most favorable hours of the day, at midday, it's only pumping 5 cubic meters per hour when it could be pumping 20. The lower graph shows a separate household survey of water collection times and highlights that the problem in this network is not that the system is technically underperforming, it's being underutilized. 50% of all water is collected early morning and evening when tap stands are not open, so people have no choice other than to use hand pumps. This pump could provide double or triple its current output. We used a sun tracker app to analyse shading at different times of the day, but it's so obviously a problem at many sites. 50% of systems were affected by shading to some extent. Avoiding shade totally is a challenge, as the camp is densely populated and sections are densely vegetated, but locating solar panels in the shadow of storage tanks or pump houses is totally avoidable. It wasn't possible to quantify the impact of this for each site, the limited time we had, but as the graphic illustrates, the relationship between power loss and shade is non-linear, so it's likely to be very significant, with the greatest impact in monsoon months. These graphs show two systems during the wettest months of the year. The top graph is water supplied, and the lower graph is corresponding rainfall and irradiation for the same days. There are only 3 days when there's less than 10 litres of water per person. The vast majority of days, people have 15 litres or more. Feedback from focus groups confirmed that this was acceptable and people used hand pumps to make up the difference. Half the networks had the option to be connected to a backup diesel generator in the event the solar pumping alone was insufficient to meet demand. We found that in almost all cases these were not being used. This graph is a direct comparison between a standalone solar pump, which is the yellow bar, and a hybrid pump, where a solid blue line indicates the pump operating by PV and white and blue line operating from generator. The top graph, during a sunny month, both systems rely 100% on solar. On the 10th and 11th, which is presumably a very overcast or rainy day, you might expect the generator to be switched on and to make up the shortfall in output. That doesn't happen. During the overcast month of July, output from both systems reduces, but only on half of the days does the hybrid system actually use its generator, and even then it's only for a short duration, so it doesn't meet the deficit. This is consistent with findings elsewhere. In theory, a generator offers a 24-hour supply, but adding a generator also introduces an additional level of complexity to the system, and in practice, due to cost of operation, availability of fuel, breakdown or maintenance, they often don't improve supply as intended. We concluded that investment in generators is not justified in Kutapalong, especially because hand pumps provide an alternative backup source, but solar alone can't fulfil need. This graph illustrates how human interference can impact on performance. It was unclear why daily production was so variable until around the 19th of April, when the operators were instructed to never touch any of the controls and leave the pump in automatic mode. And from that point on, a dramatic improvement in running hours is evident. The operators were acting in good faith, but unaware their actions were detrimentally affecting the overall performance of the network due to a combination of closing gate valves to a tank or tap stand and manually turning the pump on or off. An operator doesn't need to make these judgments. So what were our overall conclusions? At the headline level, it's phenomenal to think the solar pumping could meet the water demand of a refugee camp the size of a large city. That's not yet the case, but solar will become the primary means of supplying water if the master plan continues to be rolled out. Focusing down to an operational systems level, there's a range of factors contributing to underutilization and underperformance of solar pumping systems, which do need to be addressed to maximize the impact and investment that has been made. The overall takeaway for me is that production data, which is the most common performance metric, only tells part of the story, and to avoid jumping to the wrong conclusions, it is important to analyse all data and understand behaviour of the whole system. Water service is only as good as weakest link. That might be the solar pump, but it could equally be another component of hardware, such as the number or location of taps, available storage capacity, orientation of solar panels, or it could be how a system is operated and whether it's really responding to the needs and preferences of consumers. Thanks for listening. I'm happy to take questions.
Brilliant. Thanks very much, Bryan. Great to see lots more data again. While people are kind of formulating their questions, I just wanted to kind of kick off with asking you to kind of, how do you see this kind of, you talk about underutilization as if that's a kind of major problem. But I mean, in terms of having spare capacity or headroom, as it might be called in the kind of UK water industry, what do you think the optimal level that you should be aiming for is? And what changes would you therefore make to your designs in the light of the data that you've collected?
Yeah, I think the initial issue, so one of the reasons we were invited to do the study was that UNHCR and some of the implementing partners, that there was a perception that the solar pumping systems were not able to produce sufficient water for the population in those camps. Now, I think through this study, we were able to show that it's not that the solar pumps are not capable of that. It's the way they're being managed and underutilized. I think there's specific contextual circumstances in this area of Kutapalong in the mega camp. There's an alternative source there. There's lots of shallow wells, and people were preferring to use those because they were closer to their dwellings. So one of the things, if we wanted, we want people to use safe chlorinated water. So one of the weaknesses of the designs, if we'd have had more tap stands closer to people's houses, then that would have utilized it better. But there's a whole range of factors. I think the systems were designed appropriately. What wasn't in place, and some additional thoughts to just encourage more usage of that. And for example, it becomes a self-fulfilling prophecy that there's a concern that the supply can't meet demand. So then some of the agencies were encouraging users just to use the tap stands for drinking purposes, not for other domestic uses. And then because of the concern for demand, they were limiting the opening hours of tap stands, but that was inadvertently reducing the output of the solar.
Thank you. There's a couple of questions in the chat. Sorry, Andrew, did you want to come back at that one?
Go ahead.
And there's a couple of questions in the chat. I think one you may have just addressed in part is how you're addressing the underusage of the solar systems. And then a second question on what are your thoughts about the scale of population density or breakpoint at which solar pumping networks become the most cost-effective option in comparison to those kind of point source options such as hand pumps?
Okay. Second question. So in terms of density of population, I think for me, there's very few limits to solar pumping now. And some of the largest systems that we've installed, Oxum's installed in other countries, are pumps of 100 kilowatt motors. So you can have huge outputs comparable to any other diesel powered or main systems. So as long as the output, as long as the quantity being supplied is sufficient for the demand, there's almost no limits to it. On the other side, in terms of how small systems can be, I agree with the comments of the earlier presenters. I think there's a role for both solar and hand pumps. Certainly my experience more in East Africa, in remoter areas, I would certainly favor hand pumps where you can't ensure the safety and security of the solar panels, which theft is still an issue. The first question?
The first question I think you answered in part was how you address the underusage of the solar system, but I know you spoke about a few aspects in response to Andrew's question. So is there anything you want to add?
No, just I think there's a range of issues, and it's just understanding all the factors that contribute to solar. So being aware that you've got these 8 hours limit in the solar day when the pump can work. So ensuring there's sufficient capacity there, being aware of consumer needs and when they demand the water, if they need the water at 5 o'clock in the morning and the tap stands aren't closed, that's an obvious thing to be addressed. This study was done just before the COVID pandemic, so I'm not sure how many of the recommendations agencies have been able to implement since then, actually.
Great, thank you. Just a quick follow-up from me as well, and kind of building on what's been said previously. In terms of building resilience to these networks, obviously one thing you mentioned is the availability of hand pumps, which perhaps was a positive and a negative in terms of the use. Is there an argument for actually building in, you know, if somewhere else where there's perhaps not that availability, is there an argument for building in that resilience through other means? Would you prefer to go for the diesel backup or hand pumps? How best do you think you build in that resilience for those situations, perhaps when the solar pumping can't provide what's required?
I think it would depend on context. So here, because the shallow wells and hand pumps are there, it's less critical. Different context, it's understanding how critical is it that you have a minimum daily supply. If you can't guarantee that through solar, then yeah, potentially diesel backup may be justified. But by tweaking the design of the solar, you may also be able to increase and meet that minimum demand. So thinking about the optimal size of your storage tank. I think in practice, it's the observation in Kutapalong, we had a minimum of 1 day's storage. You could add an extra buffer, perhaps in other locations, by having 2 to 3 days worth of storage. Also thinking about power blending, so maybe you don't need a backup, the full size, a larger generator, maybe just a smaller generator, and you can have power blending now. I think some of the new solar systems, so you can guarantee a minimum continued pumping, even if there's only a limited amount of solar.
Great, thank you. And a follow-up again from in the chat on similar lines, says in terms of either increasing reservoir capacity using storage batteries or using generator, what would you recommend in terms of, kind of cost and technical efficiency for rural community systems?
I certainly wouldn't recommend batteries as backup. I think my own experience elsewhere of rural communities, observation has been quite negative in relation to generators. Just the reliability of generators, they add an additional complexity to the system, and they fail for a variety of reasons, whether it's spare parts, lack of fuel. So I would advise keeping it as simple as possible, based on most of the areas where I've worked.
Great, thank you. Andrew, how are we doing for time? Do we need to move on?
Then maybe for one last question, okay. I think, before we move on. There's one question here from Donald John. One limitation for solar pumping in some areas is the hydrogeology, the low aquifer transmissivities, for example, in East Africa. Is there any, are there any solar technologies that can pump at very low rates that might suit these environments?
I think there are solar pumps for any size of borehole. I guess once you get a yield of 1 cubic meter per hour below that, then I think a hand pump does make sense to put a solar pump where possibly you might get intermittent, even with a hand pump, sometimes you get intermittent pumping whilst the well recharges. Just maybe a concluding comment. I'm not a solar expert myself, but my colleagues a part of a project, the Global Solar Water Initiative. So there's a website, thesolarhub.org. I'll put it in the chat box, and that has a huge amount of information on solar pumping. They've done a lot of evaluations and studies, and they've got a lot of publications, including a very good solar pumping textbook manual, which is freely available.
Fantastic. Thank you very much indeed for taking all of those questions. And it's just great to see, these two presentations kind of coupled together, where we're using technology, we're getting the data and the analytics, and really starting to fully understand what's actually happening on the ground, thanks to the data that's now available. And hopefully that will also be relevant moving into the next presentation, where we're looking specifically at GIS, geographical information systems, and their role that they play in hand pump maintenance programs. So So I will start that one now, and then there'll be a final session of questions after that.
Hello, my name is Bryan Ramirez, and I'm a graduate assistant and master's thesis candidate in the Sustainable Engineering Program at Villanova University in Villanova, Pennsylvania. Today, I'll be presenting a preliminary analysis of a pilot GIS-based asset management platform to promote hand pump sustainability in Ghana. The objective of this research is to analyze the impacts that the implementation of a geographic information system, or GIS-based asset management platform used in conjunction with the circuit rider model, has on the performance of hand pumps in Ghanaian communities over time. More specifically, we're analyzing baseline inspections of hand pumps and comparing that collected information with that of the related most recent inspection carried out by a pump mechanic. I'll get a little bit more into the details as to which metrics we're looking at more specifically in just a few slides. This research stems from a partnership with the NGO Lifetime Wells International, who since 2004 worked to install wells in communities within both Ghana and Tanzania. Through its partnerships with local governments in these countries, Lifetime Wells is able to identify communities that need a reliable, potable water source. After a community is identified, a borehole is drilled and a hand pump is installed and maintained, all using a network of in-country experts locally hired by Lifetime Wells. In Ghana specifically, over 1,000 hand pumps have been installed, and pump mechanics service hand pumps in the Volta, northern, and northeast regions of the country. Now for a little bit more on the collaboration between our implementing partner and us. Since 2014, Lifetime Wells has partnered with the Center for Humanitarian Engineering and International Development at Villanova University to improve its operations in Ghana specifically. Essentially, undergraduate students, graduate students, as well as expert university faculty all contribute to the center's mission of supporting its partners through remote and in-country projects and research initiatives. This slide in particular shows how the center has provided support to the NGO over the last 7 years by way of technical support, capacity building, and research services, each with several key outcomes as shown here. And just as a brief example, for technical support since 2014, one of the key outcomes that came out of that support was a baseline assessment of hand pump functionality. Now I'll be sharing some more pertinent information and background regarding the current issues existing in this field and how that ties into this research more specifically. So Davis estimates that failure rates for water points in developing countries are in the order of around 40% as per a study published in 2014. And circuit riders, or CRs, as a reference throughout this presentation, are groups of mechanics technicians that visit a circuit of several dozen communities on a regular maintenance cycle. Research by Queller et al. From 2016 shows that this model has been proven to be successful compared to its traditional counterpart, which generally is a reactive maintenance approach as opposed to a more proactive one. So in 2019, a pilot geographic information system-based asset management platform was developed and implemented by the center at Villanova as a tool to aid Lifetime Wells Ghana in their management and operations. And the platform incorporates the use of ICT4D via mobile surveys to track the status of hand pumps across their life cycle and keep updated maintenance records, all of which are accessible via an online dashboard, which I'll touch base on in just a few slides. The system was built using GIS software and uses geospatial locations to uniquely identify each hand pump and link maintenance records over time. Also during 2019, Lifetime Wells transitioned its area mechanic program into a more traditional circuit rider model, wherein mechanics are expected to visit each assigned hand pump at a minimum of every 60 days. Whereas numerous platforms already exist for the purpose of mapping and monitoring water points in developing communities, the platform that I'm describing here has the express purpose of helping facilitate the circuit rider program and keep track of hand pump maintenance records. So the mobile surveys that I previously mentioned were developed for the specific operational model of Lifetime Wells in Ghana. So as pump mechanics routinely visit hand pumps to carry out inspections, they complete a survey, a screenshot of which you can see here on the left-hand side, that collects information related to the visit and ties it to a geospatial point in a GIS database. A repository of inspection information from each maintenance visit related to each hand pump is then stored on the cloud and is accessible to Lifetime Wells management via the use of an online dashboard, as is shown here on the right-hand side. Through this information management system, the circuit rider model is supported and allows for easy access to pertinent information collected over time. Now I'll talk a bit about the methodology used for this project. First, because there were maintenance inspection data spanning from 2014 to the present across several iterations of maintenance surveys, it was necessary to clean up and consolidate this large amount of data. This was done to ensure there were no duplicate points, that we had consistent survey questions being asked across all data sets, and to streamline the specific data analysis later on for both our research and for future research. This cleanup and consolidation was done using the ArcGIS Pro software. The six metrics that you see on screen that we then decided to use for our analysis were taken from questions asked in the maintenance surveys that were completed by pump mechanics whenever they visit a site to carry out an inspection. For each metric, we rated the corresponding answer to that particular question on a scale from 1 to 3, with 1 being the worst or lowest performing and 3 being the best or highest performing for that particular category. It's important to highlight that in order to carry out a consistent, non-biased analysis, we filtered hand pumps that had answers to each specific metric for both baseline and most recent inspections, and because there were a variety of iterations of maintenance surveys tied to a variety of different hand pumps, not all hand pump sites had answers to each metric we looked at. Therefore, the end value for each metric differs. Lastly, we then calculated an overall rating for the change in pump performance over time, comparing baseline versus most recent inspections for each of the six metrics. For the results of our analysis, starting with stroke performance, high-performing hand pumps were defined as those with 4 or less strokes required to water yield, mid-performing were defined as those with between 50 and 30 strokes required, and low-performing were defined as those with more than 30 strokes required. As the graph on the left-hand side shows, there was an overall increase in the percentage of pumps that improved their stroke performance over time. Interestingly, the average stroke count for the baseline inspection was lower than the most recent inspection, implying that stroke counts worsened marginally. Looking at the standard deviation, however, we realize that the majority of improvements or regressions happened on the extremes of the stroke count spectrum, meaning the majority of these hand pumps remained in the same rating of low, mid, or high over time. For pump functionality, we had both the high performing, characterized as whether water flows from the hand pump, and low performing hand pumps, characterized as whether water doesn't flow, to this metric increase for the most recent inspections compared to the baseline and decrease to zero for the mid performing hand pumps, which were characterized as between 5 and 30 strokes to water flow. So for the remaining metrics that we analyzed, answers to the survey questions were rated either a 1 or a 3, with 1 being the worst or lowest performing and 3 being the best or highest performing for that particular category. For the maintenance requirements shown on the left, low performance was defined as those requiring maintenance repairs of some kind, and high performance was defined as those not needing any maintenance of any kind. Results show that there was a decrease in high performance pumps over time, indicating that overall the need for pumps to be maintained increased comparing most recent inspections to baseline. The same goes for pumps that did have parts replaced, which were characterized as high performing, or didn't have parts replaced, which were characterized as low performing, due to required maintenance, where for various reasons over time, more pumps did not have the necessary repairs carried out when comparing most recent to baseline. It's important to highlight that the end value for this particular metric is so low because only communities that required maintenance repairs of some kind qualified for consideration for this metric. In other words, these were dependent on the number needing maintenance repairs of any kind. For perceived water quality, the high-performing pumps, which were characterized as those with good taste, smell, or color, decreased when comparing most recent inspections to baseline, whereas the low-performing pumps, which were characterized as those with bad taste, smell, or color, increased for the same, indicating a decrease in performance over time. For platform hygiene, we had an increase in high-performing pumps characterized as having a clean platform over time, and a decrease of low-performing pumps characterized as having dirty or buried platforms over time, indicating an overall improvement in this metric. So this chart here basically shows a summary of all of the metrics and the analysis that was conducted, showing percent improved, regress, or percent that stayed the same, broken down by either those that stayed the same for a bad performing, which we characterize as essentially those that were low or mid, and those that stayed the same but, you know, that were scoring well, which were the high performing. And as you can see here, the vast majority actually stayed the same, either good or bad, with some slight variations of improvement or regression. So to conclude, the first two bullets here essentially summarize what I mentioned on the previous slide regarding, you know, key takeaways. But really what we're looking at here and what I'd like to highlight is that the majority of the hand pumps actually maintain their level of performance over time, which is really promising, because if these pumps were not being maintained on a regular basis via the circuit rider model, one would expect their performance to decrease over time, but they are in fact remaining the same. So it does seem as though, you know, this model is providing more consistent and reliable performance over time. However, we do need more inspection data to draw more statistically significant, you know, conclusions and correlations between whether or not this actually is improving performance or not. And lastly, we'd like to include some more qualitative metrics via pump mechanic and customer satisfaction survey to get a little bit more of an impression from the pump mechanics and the communities being, you know, benefited by this implementation of this model, to see if they're noticing any more qualitative, you know, improvements over time as well. I'd like to thank all the people who sit on screen for making this research possible, especially Mavis Bowery and the Lifetime Wells Ghana team. On screen, you will see our contact information should you have any further questions regarding this research, and I'd like to conclude by saying thank you to all for your time and attention.
Great, thank you very much. Bryan's joining us now. So if there's any questions, then please put them in the chat. I mean, just to get us started, I was just wondering, similar to my question before, to one of the earlier presentations about the kind of overall sustainability of the data collection, data management, where do you see this going from here? And who is ultimately going to be responsible for sort of keeping all the databases updated?
Yes, absolutely. That's certainly sort of a long-term challenge is looking at, you know, how to transition over the you know, maintenance of these systems and the management of them. And that's sort of something that we're currently figuring out, you know, with our implementing partner, as far as sort of transitioning more of the services in terms of, you know, managing, you know, this data. I think certainly as we continue to develop the system out, you know, and sort of build up its resiliency such that, you know, it's able to be more user friendly as far as backend is concerned, it'll be much easier to you know, implement this, have the implementing partner, you know, take over control more fully. As it stands, you know, they currently are able to have access to all of the data and see, you know, maintenance data be updated in real time and see some basic comparative metrics via their dashboard. But I think as we sort of continue to flush out any sort of you know, minor technical issues and stuff as the system is built out, it'll be much easier for, you know, the partner to sort of take over full control and manage, you know, all the data as it comes in and be able to do some, you know, more simple analyses and interpretations based off of the data coming in.
Great, thank you. And there's a kind of related question, not about the data, but about the O&M services and how they're financed. What share is covered via user payments? How does Lifetime Wales exit strategy look to compare to support financial sustainability of service provision covering OPEX, CapMoneX locally?
Yeah, that's a great question. So right now, as per the model that Lifetime Wales has, it's a combination of both, you know, user-provided payments, and then also via the donations that the organization receives, provides funding for the actual pump mechanics to go out. And so, essentially, the way that it works is communities are responsible for providing the costs of any sort of repairs as far as parts go, and then for the current you know, situation, Lifetime Wells provides, you know, payment to pump mechanics in that way, whenever they go out to, you know, carry out their routine maintenance. As far as an exit strategy, that's obviously something that Lifetime Wells has on radar. I'm not from the organization directly, so I can't necessarily comment on the specifics of that. But what I can say, though, is the idea is, because these pump mechanics are all locally based, you know, they're all from Ghana, and there's a big emphasis on ensuring that you know, local staff are the ones that, you know, are in charge of day-to-day operations. As far as, you know, the upkeep over time of these wells, I think that it would you know, make it easy to transition out as far as, you know, transferring responsibilities, because most of it already lies, you know, with locally based, you know, communities and organizations.
Okay, thank you. There's a question there about the make and model of the pump. Can you clarify that, please?
Yeah, so they use the AfriDev pump. Forget exactly what the, you know, the latest model is, but that's what they... Yeah, exactly.
Okay, thank you very much. So there's a little bit of other chat going on. Seems like there's lots of good links and contacts being made about a range of things from this morning's presentation. The solar technology seems to be something that's picking up a lot. I would like to thank our speakers this morning. I think it's been a great session. It's been really good to see some real data. And as I said earlier, our rural water theme will continue in the next session. So after the break, we've got three sessions looking at, well, two looking at rainwater harvesting, and then we're kind of beginning quite a long theme that will continue into the afternoon about models of service delivery. So the challenges for rural water supply will continue for the rest of this day, and I hope you'll be able to join us for some of those sessions later on. For some of you that had challenges with accessing the recordings, or the sound wasn't good, the videos will be made available. I'm not sure exactly when they'll be uploaded, but there's a link through the foyer to the YouTube channel. So you should be able to find those and catch up anything that you missed. Also, some of the authors have kindly given their email addresses for any follow-up if you'd like to look at that. And if any of you had problems accessing the abstracts yesterday, or what I can suggest, because I have the same issue, is if you refresh if you're accessing them through your agenda, if you've created your own agenda and some of those links don't work anymore, just refresh the My Agenda page and the new link should appear. That should restore the links. So the extended abstracts for all the presentations are available through the platform. So with that, I think we'll close this session, and I look forward to seeing some of you in about 15 minutes time for the next one.